It is with privilege and pleasure to address you regarding this substance that is the living water that we all drink and we all have to have to be alive and flourish. And the better quality, and the more and better quality is my fervent wish. Also to introduce you to a concept that really is not a new one at all. It's not new to me. And I'm sure it's not new to you either. The water, this stuff in here is actually two parts hydrogen and one oxygen, which everybody knows. And I wonder, I asked myself many years ago, I was about 17 years old, when it came up, I thought, how could that be? How could hydrogen, this very flammable, the most flammable of all gases, and oxygen, come together to be liquid? How did it get that way? I don't know. I'm sure some of you must have thought of it. You know, to say that it is a anomaly would be really passing over one of the most important thing in our lives, because after all our bodies are almost two-thirds water, the very substance that we are talking about. So I think it would behoove us to better understand it, and I come here, and it is a privilege so for me to try to explain to you what I learned about it over a lifetime, and give you an idea, and invite you to question the very things that I questioned when I was 17 years old, and help find answers, and help point the way so that conditions like what we experience today, which is the drought, the great drought of a lifetime, can be solved, and so that this great state may flourish. So I will henceforth go into my explanations, or my show, as it were. I'm totally new at it, so please bear with me. So any questions I will take afterwards. In the meantime, I will attempt to start this, with your permission. Basically, what our intent is, or the Institute's intent, is to show you that there is water other than what is accepted by the conventional wisdom, that it all comes from the sky, because the conventional wisdom never explained how it got there in the first place. It had to have come from someplace. And of course there were all kinds of theories, including comets, ice comets. I even heard up in Shasta that we had some Martians throwing ice cubes at us that made all this water. So I'm going to the definition we will start with. Basically, it is an earth-generated substance, because we, after all of us come from this great sun of ours, which makes up our solar system. And I think we all agree that we have to start somewhere, and the conventional theory has it that we spun off from the sun in a molten form, a magmatic piece of material that somehow cooled down and created all this stuff from somewhere. And then, you know, so it has to have come from someplace, and I proposed, and not only I proposed, but people before me submitted, that it was generated out of our own planet, our own solar system. Water can be found, believe it or not, in a solid granite. You can drill 300 feet into granite, different parts of the earth. This is not unique to the foot of the Sierras. The Sierras are, by the way, extremely rich in water. The granite itself, which makes up a good part of this great mountain range, is in essence 40% water. this rock that otherwise we would look at it as a dry substance. But in fact, it is water. And under certain conditions, it will generate up to 40% by volume water. Now I'm going to show you guys a video of drilling in water in East Africa, drilling for water. And I worked in East Africa for some 12 years on and off, mostly on.
Water is essential to overcoming hunger, poverty, and disease. Yet at a time in history when we can explore the surface of distant planets, here on Earth, more than 1.5 billion people still lack access to clean, safe drinking water. Countless women and girls in developing countries walk many miles each day to fetch water for their families' drinking, washing, and cooking needs. Water often polluted by livestock, infested with parasites, and contaminated with bacteria like cholera, typhoid, and dysentery. 5 million people, mostly children, die each year from waterborne disease, double the number of deaths caused by AIDS. Without safe drinking water, health, hope, progress, and dignity are impossible. Faced with this reality in almost every East African village we visit, in 2006, Global Resource Alliance, GRA, started raising funds to drill boreholes and install pumps in some of the areas most affected. After nearly a year of frustrating delays, we succeeded in drilling one borehole in Kanesi, a poor rural village in the Mara region of Tanzania. With the closest drilling contractor hundreds of kilometers away, the cost of the borehole was high, about $15,000. Fitting the well with the solar pump took another year, and another $15,000. We knew there had to be a better way. Encouraged by the availability of expert volunteer guidance, we decided that buying our own equipment and hiring a crew of experienced Tanzanian drillers was the most cost-effective and timely approach. By mid-2008, GRA had raised enough money to take the plunge. We purchased a new top-quality U.S. drilling rig, a powerful Belgian air compressor, and used vehicles from the U.K. and Japan to transport the equipment and crew. After numerous delays and unexpected expenses, GRA's Maje Mingi project, which in the local Swahili dialect means abundant water, finally got underway in January 2009. The first borehole was drilled in Kabuyi Village at a site selected in the previous year by volunteer geohydrologist Paul Pauer. It proved to be a source of abundant, high-quality water that will meet all the drinking water needs of area residents and the nearby government secondary school. In early February, GRA's volunteer water wizard, Paul Pauer, returned once again to Tanzania and began locating more drill sites in the rural districts surrounding Musoma. One of these sites, in Utegi Village, was the location of our second borehole attempt. Residents had been drawing water from a chocolate brown river that runs through town, a known source of the village's frequent outbreaks of cholera. After pounding through 100 feet of bedrock, we begin to encounter small amounts of water. At about 200 feet down, we hit the mother lode, a river of excellent quality water under enormous pressure that rose to about 10 feet from the surface. There was so much water that our drill bit was nearly trapped in the hole by rocks washed down from above. With over four decades of experience, Paul Power's knowledge of what has been called primary water is perhaps unparalleled. The theory was developed in the 1950s and 60s by Paul's mentor, the late Austrian mining engineer and geologist Stefan Ries, though it was first formulated in the late 1890s by Finnish Nobel Prize nominee, physicist, and Arctic explorer Adolf Erik Nordenskjöld. Also known as juvenile, earth-generated, magmatic, plutonic, or fissure water, primary water is said to be generated deep within the earth and forced upwards through fissures and fractures in the earth's crust under great pressure. Primary water wells in the Middle East have been a continuous source of fresh, clean water since biblical times. If you'd like more information about Global Resource Alliance, please visit our website at www.globalresourcealliance.org. Together, we can help impoverished communities in rural East Africa achieve a life of greater hope, joy, and abundance.
Anyhow, this project is going on today in Tanzania. We have well over 100 wells now that are producing water. As some of them that are closer to city town centers where there is power available, they use the power to pump. Other places they use these hand pumps. So it really has made a big difference. Basically, this I refer to how primary water is generated. It is generated as hydrogen and oxygen under pressure forms the substance first as vapor, and as it comes up, it becomes more and more solid. And this is an upward movement, as opposed to the water that everybody's familiar with that comes from the sky only. And this is the basis of all waters really that is on our planet. At one point in time, in the very beginning, it would have had to be formed in such a way. On this poster, try to attempt to illustrate basically the primary and the secondary water cycle. The primary water cycle we refer to is how the water was originally made even before there was an atmosphere, because water actually contributed to the being of our atmosphere, because our atmosphere is made up of water also. It has a degree of humidity presently, not much because we are in the dry cycle, but in the times of the year it varies. And here, in the following, I'm going to try to explain that we are trying to explain how the water is formed. Some places, natural springs, such as this phenomenon. Here it shows basically a fracture, which is a faulted structure that permits water come surface directly out of magma as it makes its way up. Another one here where a well drills, say up to 800 feet into the same type of faulted structure. And we differentiate the material as a permeable substance in here, which is as you visualize the Great Valley is, that permits water soak in down to so this would basically represent the water strata in the valley from which everybody draws, and below that there's this impervious basalt that water doesn't go down any further. It gets trapped almost, if you visualize a bathtub, with a solid bottom. But it doesn't have a solid bottom because it is faulted even there, as I will try to illustrate later. And here I'm showing you basically the polluted aquifer, which is polluted because we are on the surface of it. Animals, people, and everything else. So as the rain falls from the sky, it is filtered, all the material is filtered right directly into the aquifer, thus polluting it. It makes no difference whether they are chemicals or whatever substances they are. And basically, this is what we are attempting to show. In these graphics, the runoff, all this water more or less on this graphic illustrates atmospheric water, except for this natural spring. And now alongside of the natural spring, more specific, we have these, once again, a little larger schematic in here. Again, a little better close-ups of that which I've explained earlier. And now we are showing how the atmospheric water and primary water interact. Because you see, the primary sources, as they come up these primary sources actually add water to existing aquifers. They have to, otherwise, even now, we are into the fourth year of drought. Theoretically, the whole valley should have dried up by now. I mean, we had no water, and yet many of these trees are still alive. And water tables have been drawn down, no doubt. But we still have water, and there's no explanation for it, except if we take into consideration that water that is not coming from the sky has to come from somewhere else in such a fashion as this. Now, even the bottom of lakes that we have to interact with primary sources. And we can tap these sources by drilling horizontally, depending on conditions. We can drill horizontally into them or vertically. And this just shows it in a larger illustration. Now, we are attempting to explain these sources and the origins of these waters. One of them, no volcanic eruptions are possible without adding water to the atmosphere. All volcanic explosions accompanied by water as it being discharged into the atmosphere in form of steam. It's just an absolute ingredient. And then we get some surface hot springs, such as here. Somebody must be heating that water down below, otherwise they wouldn't be hot. And I'm saying that it's probably all the people sweat who went to hell. Now, here we are trying to, attempting to show how these are also fault lines. Some of them are horizontal shears, and some of them are vertical, and how they are connected to one another. Now in here, because somebody asked me, well, gosh, what about the rivers? Well, of course the rivers too. Here on this illustration, here we are showing a structure where a fault goes all the way up to the top of the mountain, only to make a runoff that is now commingles with atmospheric water. Probably right at the source of it, where if you could get it right there, it would be pure. By the time you get down into this place, it is no longer. Now, let's go back here. this is the whole picture as I try to explain step by step. And at the end of the talk, I invite you to please comment on this. Any of your thoughts? You know, we are not finished with understanding. Water is the least understood of all substances, and yet it's the most crucial and critical for well-being over the planet and everyone. The only time we really start to take account of it is when we're experiencing drought, and when people are you know, dying of thirst. And I think we ought to go ahead and kind of take a look at it in advance, and just have to understand it better. After all, that's what makes our life. You know, originally it was thought that all the water originated from the atmosphere. It had to come from the sky, from clouds, as it evaporated from the oceans. Well, yes, it evaporates, and of course a good portion of that comes from the secondary cycle. But the primary cycle was the one that initiated the very beginning, all of it, and still contributes a great deal of water. As we speak today, our planet is expanding. It is getting larger in size. And it's not entirely due to some minor ice melt in the poles, because the total volume, even if you melted all of them, I'm not sure how much it would raise the surface of our oceans. But I doubt all that much. Yet our planet, the surface of our oceans have been rising for the last untold millions of years. We are having more and more water. We are adding more and more water to this planet. So volume-wise, this planet is growing, because those two gases, hydrogen and oxygen, are now combined to make a solid substance down below. Well, there are how many lakes and deserts that it hasn't rained, some of them it hasn't rained in 400 years, and yet you have this occurrence in Peru. Now, this water didn't come from the sky, for sure, because over there it doesn't even rain an inch or two a year. Yet you have an oasis here. Here's this water sitting there. It had to come from someplace. It didn't come from the sky, so I think I submit that it had to come from down below. And there are only two places it can come, either from the top or the bottom. And here's one in Crescent Lake, China. Now, this is one of the most famous of all. This is at the Atacama Desert, and this was one of the most noted places on the Silk Route from Asia to Europe. 8,000 years ago, this thing has been there with no rainfall. Now, these are the things. These are the anomalies that we can't pass over and just kind of write it off and say, "Well, gee." Since we don't have an explanation, we just call it an anomaly. Well, hell, we get too many of those.
Are there mountains around them that are higher?
There's no rainfall. The rain, either the rain has to come from the top. It has to be pushed down up or something. I mean, in Africa, in the Great Sahara, you have no mountains. You have hundreds and hundreds of miles of absolute desert. Now, this one in here, most of you probably not familiar with, but this is a true and a rare phenomenon, this fly geyser in Nevada. Somebody attempted in the 50s to drill a well here, and it didn't come out. I don't know what happened. The enterprise went bust. And then pretty soon, a couple of earthquakes and whatnot, and all of a sudden, some water starts sprouting out of the ground there. And this is not very far from Reno.
Is it constant or
interval? It's constant. And an interesting part of it is you look at the mineralization, the different color minerals that color it. And that's very, 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 that is really a spectacular sight. And this is right here in our country. So is this one. This is the Grand Prismatic Hot Springs in Nevada. No appreciable rainfall, no mountains to collect, no source. of course, the geysers in Iceland, that whole island is a volcanic phenomenon where, my God, geysers and hot water just absolutely come out of the ground. And this one, this is Never Spring in Herzegovina. This is noted way back, pre-biblical times. And of course, the famous Homakula Springs in Turkey. Again, not unlike the Fly Geyser in Nevada. This too shows the mineralization, many of these minerals are not ionically bonded to water. So as soon as they're oxygenated, they are permitted to settle out, as it were. And invariably, many of the gases. Water is such a complex thing, and not enough attention is paid to it. But it didn't have to be. My God, we had plenty of it in snow and every other way, so we could squander, pollute it, do whatever with it. Have to have a little more respect for our resources. Not because they're endless, but just because they're alive, and just because they too have a consciousness. We are made up, we are people, and you know, we are supposed to be conscious people. Now that stuff had to come from somewhere too. And really the water is the ultimate solvent. And that's what permits us to digest our food. And it's most important and most crucial that our water intake is that we take in water, the kind of water that we use for our digestion, our well-being. Is good water and balanced water, in balance, yet not enough. You know, they are doing now reverse osmosis, and then basically taking the salt out of seawater. Well, that's grand. There are a lot of flaws here too, because now our civilization has gotten far enough along to where we can actually remove salt through reverse osmosis. You don't have to boil it, make it steam, and then come back down and distill it, as is. But what happens? Now we have water in here that is no longer alive water. Then everybody's trying to figure out, well, we're going to have to put something back into this water to make it alive. Otherwise, what it does is you might as well just have a fifth of vodka every day that is distilled. What does it do? It leaches your bones. It wants to be in balance. It is a solvent. And it has a specific purpose to help us digest our food. And so this particular solvent has to have certain attributes. And when we go through this business of reverse osmosis and desalinization, we are creating yet another need for another technology so we can put that water back into balance and hope the heck we're not gonna mess that one up. Never mind what are we doing with the salt that we are distilling, that concentrated salt substances. We put it back into the ocean in any large volumes. We're gonna get the ocean out of whack too, because many of these critters here are used to a certain balanced condition. This is how they evolved. You can't overnight change them. And of course, the old faithful in here is another interesting phenomenon. In fact, the whole of Yellowstone has some really beautiful places, really wondrous place. This gigantic volcano. Once again, it's not that difficult to put two and two together and say, hey, here we are now, we are talking about a volcanic substance. A place that we all hope doesn't go off. We've been threatened with that scenario, but this water in here, this old faithful goes off. It doesn't matter whether it rains, snows, winter, summer, fall, it goes off in a decided time frame. It doesn't seem to care whether it rained on it, because the whole idea was that, oh yeah, that water percolates down, and then I don't know what makes it come up. And then that we have a need. Of course we have a need. Let's look at this last 4 or 5 years in this state. Never mind in the state, the adjacent states too. We are going through a real strange phenomenon, be it man-made or natural or whatever. But my God, this could lay waste to this country. If this state if California goes under, boy, I tell you what, the rest of the states have a big problem, not to mention the rest of the world. We are a very important place, and this place is truly, truly beautiful. Now, look at this place in India. This is another way these people are getting water. They dug this. This is a hand dug well, and everybody's over there waiting to get their turn to dip their buckets. And this is the 21st century. This is a kind of a joke. I thought this was a real good one. This is what the, and I, you know, it's pretty depressing. I was down in San Diego, started last year making the trips all the way back, and larger and larger tracts of land are not being cultivated. And you can see where the trees are dying. And then we have to do something besides building more canals and digging more holes in the ground. We're not even praying good enough for burning candles so it will rain, I don't know. And this is parts of Lake Pauer. And another thing too, here we are talking about digging more holes in the ground. And then what? Why not spend some of these billions of dollars and putting people to work now and taking this stuff out of these reservoirs that are already turning into beaver ponds? So as to make room for, just in case it rains. I think we ought to do more than just pay lip service to this. I mean, this stuff should be removed. This silt is fine silt, except possibly that wreck in the middle. But that silt could be redistributed again. That's fine. That's all our topsoil over there. Mm-hmm. Now, for right now, especially some of these reservoirs that are practically empty, we could put people to work. We could put people to work and do something useful instead of thinking of digging another hole. And here is Lake Oroville. This is Santa Clara County. And of course, the series dropped. These signs are everywhere now. And I worked at Tuolumne County here 2 months ago, and actually in April. And here, these are five pictures of Yosemite Half Dome. Look at the one up there this was a normal year. 12, 13, we don't have any snow. Mm-hmm. I mean, of course, now, you know, the doomsdayers, because that's all, you always have to scare everybody to death. Otherwise, nobody does anything, you know. The sky is falling, except it isn't. You know, we do have water down below. We have a structure in here that we can drill, and there's absolutely no sinkholes. Good example, Sonoma County a year ago, little less than a year ago, had an earthquake, 6.2 or so on the Richter scale. What followed that quake? A half a dozen or a dozen of their springs started flowing again. Mm-hmm. And they're still flowing. Mm-hmm. But only in Sonoma County. Well, that's where they had the quake. Now, where did all that water come from? They didn't get any more from the sky than the rest of us. There's a solution, and the solution is to drill in places where preferably in places where there is water, because there are physical indications. I have drilled all over the place. These are basically the spots that are shown on the map. And again, to illustrate the concept of more and more water added, here is South America. I'm sure that you all noticed that this South America fits perfectly over here to Africa. I mean, that is just as plain as anything could be. Now, where did all this water come from in the middle? I don't know if anybody ever wondered how come these continents kind of spread that far apart, and there are many other, but that's a perfect example of continental drift, and the expanding planet. Our planet is in fact adding untold billions of gallons of water every day, from blowholes, fumaroles, and etc. at the bottom of the ocean. Some of the water is excellent in quality, and some of it isn't. This planet makes all kinds of water. We are after the good stuff. And here, for example, if we were to drill just at the foot of the Sierras, we have an infrastructure already in place. We have our delivery system. Times like these are where we have drought. We have no backup system. We need a backup system so we could see us through 6 to 10 years worth of drought, and then use both of them. I mean, you know, there's no reason why not. But we have no backup system. Well, these are just some of the wells that I drilled, and it's really not. But I have worked now to date in different parts of this planet, and you know, there is no difference. Water, good water, bad water, water exists all over. It does come from certain types of mineralogy. You have to understand the mineralogy of the place where you're drilling. You have to see where the faults are. And then while you're drilling it, you have to make sure that you stay on top of the project and carefully supervise to make sure that you're getting the desired results. I normally, to make a location, you have to take a look at a topographic map of the place. Let's see what the anomalies are, the differences in elevation from one place to another, and how that structure was formed, where the uplifts, where the folds are. And then you can locate the faults, and then you have to go on site to make sure that somebody didn't give you a map that's just simply not so, because there are those too, that somebody made a mistake. And then you're looking at a map that doesn't exist, or they are indicating something other than what is real. Okay, this one in here I just did, as I mentioned to you guys, was in just April, end of March, April this year in Jamestown. And give you an idea what a well drilling project looks like in this country. The first one was... First of all, it involves this rig that there are better, there are newer and finer techniques now. This was an Ingersoll Rand originally, and now Atlas Copco purchased this company. But basically, this is one of their older rigs, believe it or not. But the process of drilling, the technology is going through some mighty fast changes. We can drill this well. I started to just could only drill it 300 feet. I was hoping to go 600 feet. However, I discovered while drilling that the driller confessed to the fact that he drilled one just 100 yards away that ended up being sodium. So I thought, well, where was the sodium? At 300 feet. At that point, what you see is what you get. So I don't dare go over 300 feet. It's as simple as that. I mean, you know, I didn't have even time to. Only 40 gallons. a minute. But boy, I tell you, that old guy was very happy because he did not take care of his fingers. In fact, a lot were watered down below a tough time. Into the structure that was producing water, and this was fairly shallow. Basically, the way these wells are drilled with this particular rig. You drill a smaller test hole, then you widen it out so that you can go ahead and put a larger casing into which you drill, so as to prevent the sidewalls from caving in on the bed. So now we are re-drilling, going back over, widening the hole so that we can then go inside of that hole and go down to the desired depth. But there are better methods now. But the reason I'm showing you is because on the future to have these guys wear masks, you know. You know, you haven't seen anything yet. I have one in Africa where I couldn't prevail. You know, I drilled 300 feet and gosh. In which the water is obvious. This is where you have to monitor the drilling so you know exactly what you're getting, where you're getting it from. See, these rocks, pieces of rocks are fractured. You can see that they were separated inside. In other words, this comes from a fracture. All the water is made in the fracture.
What kind of a rock you call it?
Greenstone. This is in the greenstone family.
Okay. And that's got hit at, I don't know, 20 feet, 30, boom, we were into that.
We have to put up this protective barrier. As you see, the material that washes out along with the side, some of the material that was ground up contained a fairly high amounts of manganese that clears up after a while. In other words, that zone had this much manganese, but we had to block it up with these bales of hay as not to do any more, minimize any damage to the neighborhood there. Please note that dog. That dog knew good water already. Just an illustration of one well here in the, because they were telling me, well, you know, you're not showing any. Well, I didn't even think about filming any of this stuff until the last couple of 3 years, where I can see now where maybe some of the stuff that I have been doing should be passed about, so that not ignored, so that that.
So you're gonna pull in forward?
Here? Yeah, we're gonna pull in forward right here and then lift it up. Stand it up. So this is where we're gonna have to end up.
This is where we have going to have to end up drilling.
Where do you want to drill?
Right here, I'm standing.
Can we follow it over here, or it's got to be right here?
No, because that's already out of here.
You got to be right here with
it. Yeah. Go straight in.
Still think I'll have to go. You want to go right there and then...
Yeah, because we didn't, this is already out of it. Now, there's this fault here.
Thank God he's here. Then we were going to go over here. Can you pull up a little more? I can't see now. We got to go. I keep going right over in here, but...
That's good.
Oh. Right now it's going right here.
Good.
Right
that's
here.
Fine.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Fine. Very good. See, the only thing is this is a fairly narrow fault.
Telling how deep. See, this is a cup here, obviously, and that one is a cup here too.
Yeah.
This ridge is pretty natural, so there shouldn't be that much topsoil.
Watch out, Paul. He's gonna try that.
You know. That was the road itself was the was probably bedrock. What did I tell you? We made a little water. You remember my telling you? But it's not very much, because see, the rock dust is actually absorbing it. Thank you.
30 gallons per minute. I like that. Man. And it locks, looks like it's got a, looks like this end is a little smaller, so it locks in here, too. That's where that locks it. Pretty nifty. I got new technology all the time. 30 years ago, we didn't even have PVC.
Good.
It was all steel. This is a heavy wall PVC. This is a full-on wall casing. That is capable of facing pressure.
Right. So, they haven't been bothering us for a while.
Good.
And it might be a good one for them to look at, because if you got everything contained, everything's pretty good.
Yeah. Okay.
We first found water at 185 feet. We continued drilling to 550 feet. We set the pump 3.5 horsepower, 450 feet, and we ended up with about 35 gallons per minute.
Determining that's
primary water that
we've
drilled into?
First of all, it comes out of solid rock. It's not coming out of an alluvium. Now this well was drilled in Kenya.
So all the water that we drill in the mountains is what you call primary water?
Not necessarily. It may be commingled, as I showed you on the earlier picture. This well, I drilled in Kenya. This was 300 feet of solid, 300 feet of solid granite. This we drilled through 300 feet of solid granite. So, and let me tell you, folks, it's a heck of a deal when at least 150 people. You're the only Muzungu in the whole batch there, and every eye is on you. And for 300 feet, there's no water, just dust. Okay? So that's just about the time when you wonder how you're going to bail out of this one if you screw up. This rig is from India. After they hijacked that compressor of ours from Belgium, we just had to come across the Indian Ocean with this rig. But it was a good rig, and I'm very pleased with the young man that was the driller that came with me from the factory onto the site and trained this African crew. So this rig now is drilled already another 75, 80 wells. I located I don't know how many of them, because I only hear about the ones that they had problems with. Then I hear it say, well, now you know this and that. And it turns out, no, that's nothing. So I get to diagnose long distance, but it's not so bad. You can do it through Skype. By the way, I didn't even know that they were filming this. This is an African that did this film. And I make it a practice, especially in places like, just so that they don't think that we're a bunch of barbarians or we think that they're barbarians. I've asked the owner to please that we have a benediction before we started drilling. So his granddaughter did the prayer before we drilled. And I would prefer to do that all over. Some people frown on that, but you know, I don't care where we can get help from. I'll take it anywhere we can get it. You know, and if it means saying a prayer, so be it. Incidentally, this is English, just maybe have to listen carefully.
Thank you for the person who brought on this idea. I thank you, Mama Lord, because he had a handwork of assisting your brother. I pray to my master that you are going to be the patron of us. You are going to take care of you, your provider. That's not going to be our security to your father. I pray to my father, give them, Mama Lord, they are going to help in our strength and they are going to make it in the name of Jesus Christ. We pray all this, nothing to do in my name.
Amen.
Now you're drilling. This is the beginning of that hole. Again, oversized drill so that we can place out this time a steel pipe. But we were into granite so quickly, practically, I think maybe 5 feet altogether of any kind of an unsorted or oxidized material. The rest of it was solid granite. So there were some anxious moments, let me tell you, because I had to keep looking at, make sure that. It was a very narrow structure, so I have to make sure that rig was absolutely plumb, because by the time he gets to 300 feet, all he has to be off is an eighth of an inch, and I'm totally out of it by the time I expect to hit it. Well, they would have had to boil me in oil, huh, if I didn't have oil.
How do you determine where the site is, and how often are you right?
It's not a being right, being able to correctly locate. My percentage is in the high 80s and low 90s. And it is. Listen, we use every underhanded method. The objective is to get water. And that means that you look at the geological features on the surface. You look at the map. Then you can pretty well tell where the faults are. Okay? Then you go double check in person. Make sure that there are other factors that collaborate, including mineralogy, including the neighborhood mineralogy. It all goes together. It's not any one single method. You know, these people now have these ground sensors. Invariably, they can be not accurate. So, you know, you cannot use just one single method and be sure, you know, and then count on it to be absolutely correct. You can't do that. You can, but invariably you'll be disappointed. About 11 o'clock at night. This is the only Please take note that I do check my material. This is basically cleaning the well itself. We are still blowing, using compressor to blow the water out, clean the sides before we set the casing or the pump protector. That one was 67 degrees. My mentor, Steve Reese, and Cox, some years back in the late 50s, early 60s, after Lake Elsinore lost its water due to an earthquake, because earthquakes can do two things. They can give you or take it from you. Well, Lake Elsinore was going dry. They came and drilled well, one well tested a flow of 5,500 gallons a minute, which is, by the way, what keeps this lake full. So we have water resources here. And by the way, there's no subsidence around Lake Elsinore. And it's part of the structure in here of the Great Sierras. These are the considerations that I have to. These are the items that I have to take into account when making a decision on drilling. You have to have your logistics are almost everything. This is the Safe Water Project. You know, there's solutions. I mean, everybody. I don't know what. So far, I haven't seen any good proposal that anybody come up with all these billions of dollars that they are talking about spending. Right now, we're digging more dry holes and hoping that it will rain, and I hear that we're definitely going to have El Nino. Well, that's what they said last year, and I hope they're right this time. But we could replenish these reservoirs that we do have in existence, too. And many of our distribution system is already in place. But the network to distribute water is in place already. We don't have to spend water for that, money for that. We should be drilling at the structures at the foot of the Sierras, all the way starting at Susanville, all the way down to the Mexican border. We need about 7,000 wells that would be a backup to even a 6 to 10 years worth of drought, or forever. We have an alternative here, and we have all the people. We have kids too; they have a future here. Nobody wants to motivate these kids. But what are they doing? What are we doing? This was old Steve. He passed on in 85. A pretty important piece of book information written by Michael Saltzman that basically documented a good many of Steve's wells. And I was privileged to be part of it, including California City. I don't know how many of you know where that is, but in the Mojave country. Anyhow, it is good reading. This is basically all the. I think this is all the propaganda that I got to show you. I'll take questions.
Did you ever age date that water to determine it was primary water, or do you have an age of water that you consider primary versus not?
Listen, there's no way to age date. If someone tells you to take an age date, they're telling you something that is just ain't so.
I saw one picture where you seem to be dousing.
Yes. Yes, you can douse too. I mean, absolutely, absolutely. It's not in contradiction. As I say, we use every underhanded method there is. The objective is to get water. And you guys should have been with me and watched me sweat some of that. Because, you know, only the guy upstairs is always perfect. And then there are all kinds of reasons why it is just. All you need is one, enough to shake your confidence. But if you don't take a risk and a chance, you don't get. Sir?
The question I have is about why our government doesn't take this sort of information that you have and apply it instead of the twin tunnels, which will bring the salinity of the bay up into Rio Vista, destroy our salmon, destroy our rivers, and so forth. How come we can't get this information out to our government so that...
Because this stuff is already in the pipeline. It's already in the pipeline. It's already a fact. We've got a distribution system that is reliant upon atmospheric water. And simply, we have no solution. And they are thinking of all kinds of things. I mean, they can't take any more water out of the delta. If the salt moves in on the delta, this state is finished.
Have you made an appointment with Governor Brown?
Listen, I'm not sure. You know, I really would prefer to totally stay out of politics because these people, you know, they don't seem to want to realize that Democrat, Republican, Independent, Socialist, Black, White, in between, we all need this stuff.
Right.
And if we don't pull together and do this. But see, many of these politicians, what they do, it's a favorite game of theirs. They play against each other, against one another. The Indians against the farmers, mm-hmm. the fisher people, mm-hmm. the city folks.
And always have.
And my God, then they go to solve our problems.
Mm-hmm. So what help do you need to get this information?
I'm doing it.
Okay.
Just a question. Anybody here from NID?
Of course not.
That's our local water district.
Okay, but the water here in the mountains is fractured water. We have no aquifers.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So our
absolutely. This year you didn't even have snow. So how come that water is running down in that canal like crazy?
Okay, so you're calling that primary water.
Oh, it, a good portion of it is. I mean, there is some of it is a residue for sure, but. You get up to the mountains in here. There's no. Where's the water? Where's the water table here? There's no water table here. Each fracture, each structure, just as illustrated, has its own source. And one may be fantastic, pure. The next one could be mineralized as all get out.
And shallow.
Yeah. So it's. But the invariably, if you go into the aquifers, the concept of the aquifer is. The valley, the Great Valley, which supposedly have one bathtub bottom, which it, even that one is fractured. Even if you look at the bathtub, which is the bottom of the valley, we would have, this whole place would be a wasteland already because we had no rain here for 4 years.
We had a lot of rain here. We're the second wettest county in the state.
In talking about?
We had 40 inches of rain here.
When? What was this?
This last water year and the one before, and the one before.
Well,
and then before that, we had 60.
Then how come, if we had all this water, where is it?
We're not keeping it in cisterns and in swales and things like that.
Well, also, now, remember, we have several problems here. We are entering the 21st century. And the 21st century is all about atomic energy. These crazy people like Fukushima, what happens if we have an accident? One major nuclear accident, and here we have all these surface reservoirs. That's all we have. Now, you suppose, if we're going to start glowing all of us in the dark if you drink that? We're going to need to be able to get after water that cannot be polluted.
I was curious about the separation of secondary and primary water cycles, because in your initial poster and throughout, you continually said that those waters actually co-mingle. In your diagram, you showed how some of those deep springs would come up and enter into an existing...
Only certain places.
Reservoir. But then that water would evaporate and be part of the atmospheric cycle and part of the deep magma cycle as well. So really, it's one water cycle is what I'm seeing.
No. Somehow, I guess I wasn't clear enough. Because you see, you have the concurrently, you got two cycles in operation. You got the primary cycle, which is still yet in operation. This planet is very much alive. Volcanoes go off daily, and new fumaroles and water is added to this planet. New water. We have this planet is growing in size. However outrageous that sounds, but it is. Sir?
I just wanted to mention about the 40 inches of rain each year. Each drop of that is spoken for and owned already, you know. And as far as the above ground, California, you know, Colorado, they own more than flows through it. So it's like, as far as the politicians are concerned, they don't care because they own the Colorado River. Like, yeah, it's essential.
How far would you think, if you're drilling here in this area, how far do you think you would need to go down approximately? And is the drilling equipment available?
Well, this particular area, because we are talking about consolidated rock, you're not talking about the valley where you have alluvial fan. You could have as much as 200-300 feet of alluvium on sorted gravels, soils, and so forth. Before you even get down to the bottom of that fracture. In here, you practically, in most of the places, you would immediately start into granite. So again, you would have to look, it will be different from one site to another. Some places you get springs in here, never mind. Now those are actually primary sources. Because there's nothing feeds them, especially if they come from a mountaintop.
It could be anywhere from a few feet to a couple hundred feet.
Or even a thousand.
Or a thousand.
Yeah.
Okay.
Paul, this might be too broad of a question, but if you were looking at a solution at a county-wide level, mm-hmm. and you were looking for the infrastructure that needed to happen, for example, in Nevada County, what would be your way of approaching the problem? Would it be a series of wells? Would it be working along what we already have in place with NID? How would you approach that?
I would take a look at the infrastructure that exists now. Where is the distribution system? Where are your pipes? Where are your water storage tanks? And take a look at that. See if we could locate structures nearby so that we could at the least cost to tie into that. You follow?
Yeah.
Can I add to that? I spoke to Bill Falcone, Nevada City Engineer, actually this morning, and was telling me about Paul coming here and about the concept of Nevada City providing its own water for its city. And instantly, Bill Falcone said, well, you know, across from the gun range on Gracie Road, there is something called Canada Hill Mine. And there's actually a spring where the water pours out onto the surface, then it goes underground again, then pops out again and underground again. And he said that is actually where Nevada City's water storage tank happens to be. So right there, again, I think what we have to do is find where do we store our water and find the nearest location to, you know, hit that primary water source and use the infrastructure already in place.
I would dissuade surface storage as much as possible, potentially for fire protection, etc., but for overall human consumption. mainly because I think this century will challenge the young people to try to get water that will not be contaminated. And I'm not talking about pesticides now. I'm talking about a potential nuclear accident, or maybe even an idiotic war. That's not even mentioned that.
Which has already happened. Yeah. It's not a future thing.
That's just not
So here we are. Its time is now, mm-hmm. and I think we are getting we are put on notice with this drought, in my opinion.
I have two things I want to say. First of all, about the whole community thing, I think that finding the areas where a community source could be found that puts out copious amounts of water, like the 800 gallons of water, blah, 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 is the thing to do. And whether that's on BLM land or whatever,
it doesn't matter.
You know,
it doesn't
we need
matter.
To start finding that. I'll give you an example. During the fire that we just had, my neighbor, who lives at the top of the mountain, has an 800-gallon-a-minute well.
There you are.
He has, and he's at the top of the mountain, okay?
What is that?
The chalk bluffs. And he has a 4-inch pipe that comes out of his well, okay?
Yeah.
It broke during the fire, and it was a big deal because he couldn't get down the hill because of the road. That he couldn't get there to get it fixed. Anyway, he got it worked out. But he ended up supplying copious amounts of water to the firefighters in order to put that fire into some kind of control. But the point is his well, he's just got one well up there. Mm-hmm. He's got 50 acres up there.
Chances are it's a major.
And all we have to do is go to the top of the mountain.
Yeah.
In my experience, it's everywhere at the top of the mountain.
Isn't that amazing?
Yeah.
Now,
people think it's the opposite.
You go in the valley to drill because the water runs downhill. Well, now, you know, he shouldn't have any. Actually, all of it down in the valley.
Right. in my neighborhood, all the best wells, 100 gallons a minute and whatnot, are at the tops
at the
of
top,
the ridges.
Yes.
Okay, that's where they all are. The other thing I wanted to ask, though, is what is your experience, if any, with rotary drilling versus the old...
Well, no, that thing is out. We don't pound the ground.
I know
anymore.
That, but it seems to produce decent wells.
What you mean
the
pounding?
Pounding, yes.
Well, yeah, if you can afford that. You know, I'm sure all of you seen these tremendous derricks that they built for oil, or those wooden derricks that cut. You know, they used the very best duck fir and built these derricks. You know why they were that tall? Probably not thought about it, but you know, so that they could lift up this piece of steel and drop it from up there to shatter the material, and then they had to muck it out and then throw it again.
Yeah, but now there's the in-between stage, which has an engine that drives the thing. I know of one.
Well,
and
it
produces a really good well because the rotary drill kind of pushes the stuff back into the fracture.
It depends. It just depends on how you do it.
Yeah.
It depends on how you do it. What speed are you going? What kind of a material you're drilling? For example, if you're drilling granite.
What?
You know, if you're drilling granite or even basalt type structures, because you get fractures in those too. You could. The only way you do that is literally with a hammer bit. There is a rotary hammer that pounds away, breaks everything up, but at the same time you got to have a driller too that knows how to drill.
I know.
It's not really a question. It's a comment. I've drilled for 15 years,
mm-hmm.
and a cable tool I've drilled, and then rotary, mud rotary. And when we were talking about Renette was talking about the water coming out, going back down. What we did probably 20 years ago is we took an old mine. And instead of drilling them a well on their property, they had a natural spring coming out of this mine.
Mm-hmm.
And we actually concreted this and put in steel plates. And the mine and all the mountain where the water was coming from was storage. And you can't even calculate the millions of gallons.
Sure, I did.
Instead of letting it leave your property.
You just have to be careful
for where it's coming from.
Interesting. Siskiyou County is very much like you guys here, because that's gold country too. And I worked with this well driller, and he kept poking dry holes of this displacement. He says, could you come up and take a look, see what I'm not doing right here? Because I'm drilling in the right, the structure he was drilling in was definitely faulted. So I went up there and looked at it. God, you know, it had me stumped. I could not understand why. Why? And here was a 10 stamp mill next to this place. And never on a 10 stamp mill that must have been in operation for, well, it was supposed to be in operation. I just didn't know where the material came from. So now I'm down to this Mickey Mouse rod. I have absolutely no explanation of what is the matter here. It is contrary to everything that I knew. Mineralogy was there. Everything was there except the water. So now I'm wandering around with my dowsing rods, and I'm wandering over this ridge, totally perpendicular to anything that is in the books. And it reads water. I'm thinking, what in Sam Hill is going on in here? So I told Warren, I says, you know, you better quit drilling. Let's get a backhoe, because if we break through this rock, it says 5 feet down, we're going to have water. I said, I don't know why, but it says so. How am I going to argue with this? So he got a backhoe, and this is, it's there, even now, very much there. So he gets the backhoe, and he's banging away on the top of this rock, pretty, pretty solid material, and just banging away. All of a sudden, splash! You know, I thought, what in Sam Hill? Got the flashlight looking in there, look down there. Sure, there's standing water. Never mind, there's a piece of timber that's floating on top of it. Well, that was the portal for the King Midas mine that was sealed off some 50, 75 years ago, that went from Mugginsville all the way to Quartz Valley. That thing is a mile long. You realize how much water we had there? That boy had more water than the dang river. So that was the explanation, totally against all. But you know what happened? All the while they were blasting, because they drill, blast, muck. That used to be the old way of mining. Well, in blasting, gosh, they cracked every structure. Everything was flowing in there. So that was we'll talk about a reservoir. Yeah.
What percentage of the primary sources actually have pressure versus that you have?
They all do.
They all have pressure.
I have never seen one, even if you hit them like this one on film here.
Yeah.
That was 300 feet. Do you realize that water has to come in at 150 pounds per square inch pressure of 300 feet in order to get to the surface?
Right.
And, you know, pressure and volume are not the same. Volume-wise, you can pump that 700 gallons a minute out of a 6-inch hole, but it will still, they stop pumping. The minute they stop pumping, it comes right back and then flows 50 gallons a minute.
Well, you showed, what was it, 50 gallons a minute natural flow, and then you pumped on top of that?
Well, then they could use, that thing now supplies 15,000 people with water, that one single well.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. So they built a couple of tanks out of concrete on the top of the hill, and they're pumping all over the place now. So that's only one well. That would make me nervous. They should have a backup for that one. You should at least have a backup. But
I'd like to just clarify just one thing. My understanding actually is that groundwater doesn't flow downhill. It moves and changes to pressure. I just want to put that out there so that we're thinking correctly about groundwater. Surface water will flow down. Groundwater actually moves to changes in pressure. But what I wanted to clarify, Paul, is that, so your understanding of primary water is that it's in fractured rock and that it's under pressure. But we've never really age dated it, because age dating is not something that you believe in. I'm just curious, because I've worked at a university before, and we've age dated water to be 50,000 years old, and I've been radiocarbon dating, and I'm just curious where your
carbon carbon dating you can use on carbon. You know, carbonaceous material. Water is not. You know, it. You know what they say. They, of course, they always have an explanation. Now, tell me. Now, you know. For one, they discovered under the Great Sahara Desert in Libya that there is one such structure there that has estimated by volume seven times the volume of the Nile River. Okay. Now, this crazy man, Gaddafi, for 30 years, he started drilling for oil, and then he suddenly discovered that he's got all this water. So what the heck has he been doing after that? Not only blowing up our airplanes, but he's built himself a pipeline, a system where he was ready to turn. Hey, listen, that's got to be one of the most expensive pieces of real estate that's a sleeper.
Well, that leads me to my other question. So I'm wondering, if indeed we tap into primary water here in our county and we can resolve this drought, really, should we go back to watering our lawns? Should we be showering every day?
I think that you could be a little bit more responsible. Unless you have a goat, I wouldn't plant a lawn. You know, at least you can milk the goat. But if you just keep chopping this grass week after week, I just never was much in favor.
I'm a bit conservative, and it just seems to me that we're better off working with what we have than trying to mine for more. I mean, already we've saved 45% of the county.
Absolutely. Conservation is an absolute must. But remember that we have a problem with surface waters already. And the water is as follows, is chemicals in the water. So we have to have these systems with which we purify. Never mind contaminated with bacteria matter. So we have to now chlorinate.
Isn't it true though that groundwater discharges to surface water in topographical lows? Streams, rivers are actually part percent groundwater. They're not just precipitation.
I'm not sure I understand what your statement
is. I'm just referring to the fact that surface water is not just surface water, it's actually a percentage of groundwater in part.
Well, you say groundwater, I would prefer to use the word primary. Yes, it's commingled. Actually, as I stated earlier, it would not be possible for this valley to already have sustained itself with the agriculture it has, had it not had some contribution from primary source. Because we haven't had enough rainfall in this state.
You just said it, and I think this is a issue of changing our thinking.
Yeah, but you see, the thing is...
More. Let me just finish. And the most important thing is changing how we describe water, that it is not a resource, it is source.
Yes, and you know, it is a very important, valuable. It is not to be squandered.
It's beyond value. It's invaluable.
It's invaluable. Without that, we won't have life.
Yeah.
And then especially with having contaminated most of it.
Right.
I mean, we have already, parts of the valley that I used to drive through 40 years ago, coming north from south. You could drink water at the service station from a drinking fountain. Heck, now you can't, because the nitrates, they're over-fertilized in some of these places, and that has a cumulative effect. Mm-hmm. You know, you're just not going to get rid of that stuff. So now you have water that is, and places... And this stuff I may be crazy, but it's got a special thing about it that is very much alive, and it's almost like it's got a mind of its own.
How could it not?
Yeah. Well, you know.
Yeah, we've polluted our current water system. Why would we be having primary water?
Yeah, a couple different comments. I'm Steve Baker. Number one is, a number of years ago, I had the opportunity to interview Dr. Eldridge Morris down UC Davis. He's a plate tectonics guy of guys. He's right there where it all started. And he really supports, if you didn't have water deep in the system, in molecular, not as an H2O, but just the components are there, if that was not present down deep, we wouldn't have plate tectonics. You wouldn't have the movement of the continents as they are. So, I mean, this is a real thing. Now this is my hydrogeologist hat here. If I was to, just like what Evelyn's saying, how do we fingerprint this thing? I want to know that it isn't.
You know,
my point is, what about if it's going to be a significance, if it's a significant contribution that we can measure? I think the national laboratories would be involved. I think the US EPA would be involved. I think the US Geological Survey would be involved. A water budget would be a good tool to use.
The only yardstick that I'm aware of, and that is a dubious one, is the tritium level of the water, because we've introduced tritium only after the first atomic testing, when we dropped the bomb. Okay, that was the time when we managed to contaminate the entire planet. Has traces of tritium, believe it or not. From that date on, our water was not the same. Our oceans, our rivers, none of it. So, but it has a half-life too. It depends on where you're getting it, how you're getting it, what lab is testing. that is such a tricky and sensitive measure that I would not, I would send it to, I bet you'd send to 10 different labs and you'd have 10 different results. So much for carbon. You can't carbon. How are you going to carbon date water?
Well, they've been, you know, checking the age of, you have the ice up in, you know, these glaciers, and they estimate the age. How are they doing that?
That's like compression. It's by compression. It's actually by compression.
Yes.
But the density of the water, and yes, how much water has been on top of just compressing it into that space. Because
that's
what it's
that's
releasing is
so much of the age of.
Yeah, but that's even
no,
that
that's
is
different.
Even
that's
that is
totally
even
different.
That is shaking. Yeah,
so it's totally different. My dad was ag research rate 12.
Okay. Can I add something? I'd like to address what you're talking about, because this is something that people have brought up when
okay.
I speak
sure.
about, which is, oh great, so we have another source of water and we're going to destroy it too. Brilliant.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And I want to say one thing. First of all, I don't think we have much of a choice, because the truth of the matter is we now have rain that has Roundup in it. We have Fukushima and everything, but I would like to ask a philosophical question to societies. How would we do it differently if we had a second chance? How, excuse me?
I mean, eliminate our own, don't buy Roundup. I mean, we can start so many things, right? We could eliminate a lot of chemical processes in our life. But you know, I think that too, by diverting our watersheds and breaking up the general hydrologic function both locally and regionally, we disrupt our ability to actually help water recycle and to truly replenish our subsurface waters. And I honestly believe, you know, that the extent of this drought, I mean, some water districts are saving 2 million gallons a day. And it just seems to me that if we'd been doing this for 4 years in the past, we might not be here in a pinch at the moment.
Yeah, but we're going to reach a point where no matter how much water we save, there's a certain lower limit to how much we need just to survive.
Yeah, absolutely.
If the supply goes beneath that, we don't have a choice. We have to get water.
Hydrologic function is about recycling, and if you're keeping your subsurface saturated, you're keeping your atmosphere saturated, and water molecules like each other, and they'll stick around if treated in such a way that they're environmentally induced to collect.
Right, but there
it's
is,
water retention.
There is going to reach a point at which, we're saving a certain amount now and doing really well, but that's assuming that, okay, yeah, we can conserve, we could use even less, but at some point, if the supply drops below the minimum usage, we don't have a choice, we have to find a new way.
And that's what I'm sharing with you, by saving your water, you're actually increasing water retention.
Yeah, I understand that, but there is a certain lower limit that if the supply drops
I value your
below
understanding.
That line.
I don't agree with you.
Yeah, can you?
My question would be, what kind of training is required to develop a crew of people to go out and identify these sites?
Well, a curriculum that you're putting together will be predicated on at least six, like geology 101, but a whole lot more field work. At least 65-70% field, and the rest of it theories and other ways of identifying. But you see, you involve all the sciences, you involve all the earth sciences in the understanding of water. You can't just say, oh yeah, well now we got this particular part of it, we understand. It is bigger than all that. It is plants and everything else. The lady way back there.
So you've been doing this for 20 years?
How about 50?
Okay, well, you said 1995. You've been drilling since 1995?
No, I've been at it for way before that.
Okay, so are you tracking the productivity of the wells that you're drilling, and are some of them drying up, or are they still as productive as when you drilled them?
The ones that are primary in origin, and that's another indicator. There's absolutely no change. The one thing I'd like to point out, the zone of oxidation, depending on the structure, can be as much as 80 feet. In other words, the capillary, etc., will draw on the ground and the source, plus the plants. There are factors that are involved that will make it look like, oh gee, I'm losing it. But I don't drill any wells under 150 feet, period. Because the zone of oxidation is 80 feet, for heaven's sakes, that is subject to loss, all kinds of losses. You see what I'm saying?
Yeah. But are you tracking the productivity of the wells that
yes,
you have?
Yes, oh yes, oh yes, oh yes.
Okay.
Don't worry, I would say, I heard about one of them when we had that San Fernando quake in 1971. I drilled two wells. One was Steve's, one was mine, up in Cuyama Valley. I don't know if you people know where Cuyama. And it's just a few miles away from San Andreas. And that was a major quake. And we drilled. He drilled one, and then he didn't want to go back to do another one. He says, "You go up there. It's a miserable place." Anyway, we lost both of those wells. Went and I went up there to take a look. I had to go up. The farmer called. He doesn't have any water. Well, guess what? They were sheared up. Both of them were sheared up. So we had to re-drill, but only had to move over, not even a foot.
Have they ever tried to recreate in a laboratory what happens beneath the Earth's mantle to actually squeeze the rock or synthesize HCO?
Well,
and
just recently, see, this is all entering now the lexicon. Because they're not actually have to look, they're looking. I mean, just 2 weeks ago they discovered that Pluto, for heaven's sakes, is a bunch of ice mountains out there. I mean, the farthest planet in our solar system is a whole series of ice. Mm-hmm. Now we have more water, rest assured, than most people realize. It's just we just have to use it responsibly. But to answer your question, a year ago, they come up with this one mineral called ringwoodite, which is a diamond-like material. They subjected this ringwoodite, it is actually as hard as diamond. And guess what they were able to squeeze out of it? Water. Can you imagine that one?
So there's hydrogen and oxygen?
Yes, absolutely. The makeup of every single mineral at one point in time originated, had to originate with water. Sure.
Are the same, you know.
Oh, absolutely. They all originated with our sun, that's why we call it the solar system,
yeah.
I think, then it would be safe to assume, say that, yes, they all have the ingredients.
Yeah.
So if you were drilling down into granite, say, how much would it cost per foot to drill?
Right now, I couldn't even quote you because these guys are taking advantage. Forgive me, driller. They are absolutely having a field day. The wells that they used to charge $15, $20 a foot for, now they're charging $75. Okay? So this is, but this is almost like a wartime situation. I think the people ought to get together and say, hey, wait a minute, let's use some sense here.
One of the things that, in relationship to whether new water is appropriate or not, new water, we're looking all over California for new water. They're looking to desalinate the oceans. That's a form of new water. There's atmospheric water that you can get from a condensation perspective. So I think utilizing this source of new water, there's nothing wrong with that. This is a blessing. This is a gift. And if you could, you know, I live in Sacramento, so, you know, I would have to work hard to have access to this water. But I mean, for you in this community, I think this is an amazing gift. But, and also because, you know, I think if individual communities can use these sources in an individual way, then you don't have to build billion-dollar tunnels that take, you know,
that's got to be the most insane proposition I've ever heard of.
Yeah.
$50 billion. They spent $1 billion on just on phony bogus environmental impact studies. I mean, come on.
It's been a crazy process, but anyway, the question then also I have is, what would it take? Like, how many wells would you think would it take to this community, like, to make it self sufficient, say in terms of water?
The lady's friend up on top of the mountain. If we could have that piece of property, and by the way, who knows, maybe three of them would do.
Wow. Right. That wouldn't be a... I would like to address Renette's question, because I think it was an excellent one. It is, if we had a second chance, what would we do over? And the first thing that I think we should do over is take our preposterous building standards, where we have the same water going to our drinking faucet as it goes into our toilet to flush our poo, is really stupid. And I think we should have duplicate water systems in our homes, one that goes for water that we ingest, and then another system that recycles, reuses, whatever.
You know, that's not an outrageous thing. Let me tell you a place where they already do that, because they have to do it. And that is on the Marshall Islands. I was there 2 years ago on this atoll. I don't know if any of you... Well, we sunk one of the Marshall Islands, you know, the last hydrogen bomb, so what can I tell you? But in this one in here, Majuro, I went on to Majuro, and Majuro's entire drinking water system comes from the sky. When I was there for 3 days, it didn't rain for 3 days. They had a drought. They had to have a UN aid ships bringing water. Otherwise, they collect all the water from the water troughs on the houses. And for flushing their toilets, they use salt water, so they have a dual...
We shouldn't even have flushing toilets. We should have composting toilets. But then that's a whole other matter. But, I mean, if we're going to do things over...
Well, let's take a look.
We need to stop wasting some of this really good primary water and use it to water us,
absolutely,
our vital plants, and our vital creatures.
And it makes, by the way, it makes a big difference to the plants. The plants themselves behave differently. They produce different quality foods and vegetables, depending on what kind of a water you give them. Yeah. Believe me, you guys try it and see what I'm talking about.
So I make a suggestion. There's clearly a lot of concern in this room. This is a unique community. We all seem to, maybe not everybody, but certainly a lot of people that I've spoken to in this community understand the preciousness of water. There's clearly a lot of knowledge. What about starting a community working group? Just starting with the people in this room and start applying our thinking differently.
Well, you know, you guys are in a truly unique place. This is a I have not been to this town, and I was coming from the Nevada side. And I have to admit, I was taken aback. I thought, gosh, you know, it looks like it's a mining town. Not unlike Wairika, where I live. Mm-hmm. Except that, what year was this town?
It's 150 years old.
So it's older than even Wairika, huh?
Yeah,
Wairika Gold Rush came after this Gold Rush.
Hmm. Okay, so this is like the spillover from Sutter's Mill?
About the same time, just right after, yeah.
Okay.
So you collected...
So we have a contact list there that I suggest if anybody really interested in. You probably have an email list, I assume. Do you guys have an email list for primary?
Yeah, that's true.
But if anybody's actually interested in having further discussion and maybe an actual working group, that'd be lovely. So make sure on that table out there, you put your name and information, and then we organize something, we'll shoot you off an email. And make sure it's legible, please.
Yeah. And maybe once a month we meet.
Yeah.
And please take a look. Please take a look at our website.
Already does.
You will find it absolutely.
I didn't
it has more information than some people care to read.
There will be a town hall meeting for organizing.
Right. Sure.
Yeah, I just want
a town hall meeting at the end.
Just want to add.
Do you have a date?
I will give you the date when I find out. It'll be within the next few weeks.
Okay.
El Dorado Hills already has a dual water system. They use the recycled for their lawns and for different things, and the good drinking water for the drinking. They already do that. That'd be a good model.
You mean they've retrofitted every home in El Dorado Hills, don't they?
You look into it. It was on the news. All their lawns are green, their plants are green, everything's green from the recycled water. They have two water systems. They have two separate water systems.
Wow.
Sure.
That's great.
Have you ever heard any discussion about the effects on water when it's drawn up through a pump, an electrical pump?
Say again?
Any effects on water when it's spun through a pump?
It doesn't seem to have a, there are all sorts of nozzles and what have you that are being promoted now. That's supposed to enhance water's relationship to plant growth. I frankly, that's out of my realm. And I haven't noticed any specific change between a spring system, a spring water, coming from the same source, because I drilled in places where the spring wasn't putting out enough. But I identified it to be the same water because the composition is identical, the mineral makeup, etc. So the fingerprint is there, definitely it. It's not, because you can move 100 feet away and you can drill another structure and it's not going to be the same water. See, this is where the water table enters. Mm-hmm. At any rate, I find no difference.
Well, that's encouraging.
Yeah.
Paul, you know what I think the biggest problem is a friend of mine has a pistachio farm, mm-hmm. and he has a good well, 1,000 gallons a minute. Mm-hmm. He can do all of his acres with that. The state of California has informed him to limit his pulling the water out of the groundwater because their theory is there's only so much water there once we take that water down. That's, I think, the public perception.
Well, what's happening is, it's once again, if the good citizens of this state permit the state to take over to that degree when they will tell them how much water they can drink and when to go to the bathroom,
exactly.
Then I think we are all in serious trouble. Right now, they are trying to figure out how to monitor water intake by putting meters on everybody's wells.
We know that.
Well, now they haven't even a clue one where that water came from in the first place.
Exactly.
We're not doing it here in our county because we don't have aquifers.
But I'm curious, what do we do with things about the subsidence in Sacramento that's gone on since the 1950s, and that's due to an overdraw of groundwater. Whole Central Valley is subject to that overdraw of groundwater and therefore subsidence.
Well, you know, you're making some pretty blanket statements there.
I could show you a picture of No.
I know you're just kind of making a blanket statement that applies to the entire Central Valley. And you know what? It just ain't so. Because in certain places you can drill a water well to this depth in the Central Valley, and you're going to have water. Next place you're going to have to. It's the same quality water, but what do you suppose is the difference? It's because your primary source is not as open in this one place as the other. That's just one theory. But your water quality, your TDS, and your mineralogy of your waters is not the same. So how can you possibly make a blanket statement that it's all the same?
Just sharing with you the level of concern and why folks in the Central Valley are being asked to not pump as much for crops, especially that are being exported and not really hanging around the state. That was my point. That's okay.
We are going into too many different problems. Well, we can't afford to export anything except fruit and vegetables, and pretty soon we won't be able to do that either.
What additional information is on the disc that you have for sale back at the table there?
What additional information do we have?
We've got everything on there. We've got scientific papers. We've got. All the videos that you saw, and they're complete. And we've got New Water for a Thirsty World, a complete book that was destroyed in the 60s. So it was gotten rid of. So you've got a complete copy of that. Just whatever we could find is on there.
You've got to get politics out of water. As long as you let politics stay in water, the state is going to go under.
You know, one recommendation, this is $20, front table right there if you want this, has all the information plus more. I don't know if Paul can possibly keep us updated, but I would love to know when Sacramento at the Capitol is talking about this big, huge pipeline they want to shove all the water down to, you know, Southern California. I think we should actually dress up in our business attire and go down there and with some really strong talking points and actually say, well, wait a second, there's absolutely no reason for this, and actually open up the conversation, because I guarantee you Sacramento's not talking about this.
Well, look, the only thing is that we all can do as citizens here, and intelligent, informed citizens, is not let be set up against one another. Let's not let the Indians, who cares whether they can stay in the Delta or not. Listen, we cannot let the city folk be set up against the farmers and the other way around. We're all together in this. If we are not together, let me tell you, they are going to rule the day.
Yes. There is a group, Restore to Delta, grassroots outfit. Contact them. They've got a great...
No, we can't. We can't let that happen, folks, because they are going to go ahead and put... Then they're going to decide who's going to have water, how much water. The hell, don't they? Aren't they controlling enough already?
And that's not the politicians. That's the corporations buying the politicians.
The same. We have a saying.
Are we blaming the politicians? But yeah.
We have a saying in a place I come from. And how we describe that. One is a dog, and the other one is a canine.
So we'll take a couple, few more questions, and if anybody has any other questions for Paul, please feel free to come on up.
Yeah, with regard to space, are you seeing any evidence on water coming from the fabric of space itself?
For where?
Any water coming into the atmosphere and into the cycles from the fabric of space itself.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely.
What sort of quantities do you think is...
That would be the interesting thing in here, because here we are right now, we are even worried about, we got so many distractions. We got global warming at the moment. That's enough to try to figure out why are we having global warming. Probably because we are putting too much carbon dioxide, so we can go and trade now air. They're going to tax the air before they all get done. So now, what next? Do we know how many volcanoes are going off underneath the North Pole? Not even a clue. One.
Right. Yeah, I'm following that kind of thing.
It's just preposterous for everybody to right away jump into all kinds of conclusions. That yes, this is the answer. Those single answers in the past have got us into this situation where we are. We never provided for a backup system in this state. And that is our problem. If we had a backup system now, we wouldn't be sweating it. And don't worry, the politicians are sweating it too.
Thank you, Paul.
I'm just curious, I'm thinking out loud here, with all the wells that are constantly being drilled on a daily basis, whether in this county or throughout the state or anywhere, mm-hmm. is there a percentage of wells that are actually accessing this primary water?
Sure, absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah. This one that you just mentioned, the one that produces 1,000 gallons for pistachios. Well, listen, of course they are accessing it. We would have already dried up.
So then, it's just frustrating why this information isn't being utilized.
Well, because it's still a control. These guys are still, they're still hedging their bets. Now they get us into a point where they're about to put meters on our wells. Mm-hmm. You know, like old Mark Twain used to say, or it's a famous quote of his, that out west here, whiskey is for sipping and water is to fight over.
True.
Sure.
When you refer to on these diagrams,
yes.
you refer to them as two separate cycles.
Yes.
But I'm also hearing you say that it's constantly being generated in a pressurized state, and it's just kind of constantly sweating and kind of coming out.
Yes.
Where is the? Because like it's obvious to see like the surface, the hydrological cycle, like. It's easy to see the cycle of that.
Sure.
But where is the cycle part of that if it's just kind of constantly coming out?
The cycle part is all the springs, all the hot springs and the volcanoes, and the other ones in the bottom of this ocean. You know, there's a place in Hawaii, and we're going to have to look that one up, which island. The folks don't have enough water there, drinking water. You know what they do? They take these bladders and dive down and swim out so far and collect the water from the bottom of the ocean. How's that for?
Yeah, the fresh water.
Fresh water,
there, yeah.
Sir?
You mentioned 7,000 wells.
Mm-hmm.
And I just did a quick calculation. Let's say roughly 50,000 a well.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. That's $350 million.
Yeah, it's a pittance.
It's a drop in the
bucket. They couldn't have even done a bogus environmental impact statement.
Exactly. I mean, this is silly. I can
really.
Yeah.
There's money to be made in scarcity. Just remember that. There's lots of
And then also the sky is falling all the time. You got to stampede these people to do stupid stuff.
Right.
You got to do that.
Yeah.
Otherwise, nobody does anything. But then they vote for this guy, and then they get to renege and say, well, you know, I didn't think about this, you know.
Just one last thing. In the short term, droughts right now, we're all vulnerable. We're vulnerable in different ways. So do things that will minimize your water use when the water's low, just like your bank account. When it's not coming in big time, you don't spend a lot. Still follow through with that. And at the same time, address some of these new ideas like primary water. What seems to jump out the most for me personally is the fact that we have fresh water coming out of the bottom of the deepest parts of the ocean, and that there are places around the world where very high elevations you have water coming out of, what the quality is, I don't know. But anyhow, water's coming at a very high level, and there's nothing even remotely close that is higher than that, because we do have hydrologic, we do have vertical gradients in groundwater.
Sure, absolutely.
So, I mean, there's possibilities here.
There's another, the other problem is that you see when you talk about like the mighty Sierra here, it can't absorb very much water. All the water that comes down fast, it runs off, boom, gone. So how is it going to build up a water table? There's no structure that could accept it.
The glitch in the, there's a lot that I don't understand on this thing, but if we have a consistent or an inconsistent amount of new water being created since the beginning of time, mm-hmm. then we would probably see an increasing level of water, either cumulative, both in the atmosphere and in our oceans and lakes and everything
now,
else.
We don't
see that.
No, the ocean, you would not see it in the oceans, because our surface waters and evaporation are pretty much limited. In other words, it's not growing exponentially we are adding to the total volume of this planet this much more area-wise. So there's only a given volume that will evaporate, depending on also sunspots, and there are all kinds of other factors.
So you're saying the addition, without us drilling more holes and accessing deep reservoirs, the additional primary water is probably somewhat small percentage-wise.
Not even a drop in the bucket, literally.
And that's why it's hard to...
But the problem gets to be is that shouldn't embolden anybody to start treating water as if it was, like flushing it down the toilet. I mean, she made a perfect sense.
It comes down to lifestyle choices, is that what you're hearing me say?
Yeah.
Lifestyle choices. On a daily basis.
Yeah, but you see, the more control we permit our good lawmakers to make for us, the less choices we have, because they're going to tell you exactly what to do.
And I just want to bring this up. I brought this up with some other officials and even the union, our local paper editorial board. We had this little fire a couple weeks ago that was really quite alarming, and I was very impressed with how quickly we had tankers and thousands of men on it, and fire engines, and it really caused me to ask the question, what happens when they can't answer the call? What happens when there's so many fires going on that we don't have the tankers or the planes or the men available? Because from what I can tell, this is now going to become the new norm. Yep. We're going to have more fires, and someday I would assume fires will be starting and we're not going to have the bandwidth. Mm-hmm. And I ask my community and our officials, what is our backup plan when CAL FIRE can't show up and save us? And I think that we have to really ask that question, whether we have tanks that are throughout the community, water trucks throughout the community, special fire-resistant gel, but these are the questions I think we have to ask ourselves.
Each community has a responsibility to itself. Yeah. Now, whether or not you can go and locate a structure in here, or you can have there would be a reason for an open reservoir. Otherwise, I'd suggest for drinking water contained tanks that may not be polluted from the outside in case there's an accident.
Right. But maybe we do have open reservoirs, so if we have some helicopters or we can, but
yeah.
I actually think that this is a very, very serious conversation that we have to start.
What if. I have a friend who's a wildfire chief, and he said last year, we were really close.
We're close, we were close last week.
Last week, right. It's not a what if, no. It is here.
Yeah. So just pose that as a question for everybody.
I hope I answered everybody's question.
Well, I think what we'll do is that we'll just close the Q&A, but feel free to come on up, talk to Paul again. The DVDs are there, and I just want to say thank you so, so very much.